Thank you very much. Good afternoon to all. Sincere apologies for this technical problem. I will try to resolve it. I will try to give my presentation over phone. I already sent my presentation, so it can be shared with you. So hope that you will follow. And apologies again for that. So good afternoon to all. My name is Evangelos Chavalopoulos, and it's really a real privilege to be here with you. In the next 15 to 20 minutes, I'm going to give you an overview of the upcoming open source plans and relevant actions of the European Commission. Well, at the end of the presentation, we have allocated sufficient time for questions and answers. So myself and the team, that is my team, that is also online, will be more than happy to answer them. Now, regarding the agenda, which is slide two, this topic, we just have only two parts. So first, I will introduce to you the European Commission open source strategy, the new open source strategy, and then I will present some related open source initiatives. Now, next slide. Some of you may have already seen that the new open source strategy, it has been already published since. If you have not seen it yet, please, you can see the URL that is on the slide. Please feel free to have a look. Now, we are very happy to see that this new strategy has been welcomed by many European open source companies and communities. Among others, we have already seen statements from Germany's OSBA, France CNLL, and APEL, the new European Trade Association. Actually, we are very glad to see APEL, and honestly, we really hope to hear a lot from them in the future. Well, altogether, these associations represent more than 400 open source ICT companies, and most of them are SMEs. We are really happy with this attention that we received because we really want to work with them. We really want to get involved with our work. Now, we also know that open source is a sort of synonym, I mean, for sharing of technological know-how. So therefore, we want to make sure that open source is available to all businesses, all SMEs, all local innovators. Well, of course, I have to say that besides positive comments, we also received some remarks from open source advocacy groups like APRIL and FSFE. We also welcome these remarks. And last but not least, we also received a comment from Open Forum Europe, and we rather agree with the comment that our approach to open source is maturing. However, all the comments that we have received so far have one important thing in common. They all acknowledge the high importance of the creation of our open source program office, about which I'm going to talk a bit later. Now, going to the next slide, before I start presenting you the main aspects of the main actions of the open source strategy, I would like to briefly talk about some red tape, because I'm not sure that everybody has understood that this new open source strategy is not just another strategy. Because as you can see from the slide, this is the fifth edition of our open source strategy. What is the difference is that the previous editions were just internal working documents at Digit, which is the Director General for Informatics of the European Commission. This is also where I work. Now, moving to the next slide, someone may ask, okay, why this new strategy is different? Well, first of all, it's not anymore just an internal working document. It is a communication to the Commission. And for us inside the organization, this makes a huge difference because it is a mandate from the College of Commissioners to us. And honestly, this strategy now goes beyond Digit. It goes beyond our IT community. I mean, it's this open source will impact the entire Commission. And among others, this new strategy encourages staff to think open and co-create. So that's very important to understand what is the difference between this new policy strategy compared to the previous ones. Now, if you see the next slide, here you may see the list of 10 actions that will be implemented under the new open source strategy. We believe that all these actions will have a big impact. A big impact inside the organization. However, I have to be frank with you, so don't expect big changes to happen immediately, but I can assure you that changes will definitely come. So for reasons of timing, from the 10 actions, I will just elaborate only the actions that are in bold together with the first one. So moving to the next slide, let's talk about first things first. So today, we are very pleased to make it official that the Commission now has an open source program office. We call it OSPO. Now, the OSPO will become the go-between for all the open source related activities at the European Commission, and we will consider the OSPO as the heartbeat of all the planned actions under the open source strategy. So moving to the next slide, as you understand, if you remember the 10 actions, with OSPO, the first action of our action plan is practically implemented. So next step is we have to change our internal software development practices. So what we want to do from now on, for new software projects, we want to try to make the source code accessible across all teams in the Commission. So the goal, the idea is to truly establish a working culture based on the principle of open source. Let me give you an example of what do I mean by that. One, if you see in this slide, one of our projects, open source project, is called LEOS, which stands for Legislation Editing Open Software. This is the internal editor that is used for all legislative texts. So LEOS is open source, and we have just started rolling it out across the Commission. LEOS is already being used by the Directorate General that is responsible for EU policies on taxation and customs. For those that may be aware, this is the so-called Digitax suit. But besides the Commission, LEOS has been also been selected by the national governments of Spain and Germany. Spain is already working with our developers on new features, and Germany is adding more developers on the project. And besides Spain and Germany, other EU member states such as Denmark, Italy, Netherlands have also expressed their interest to adopt this tool. So as you can understand, this is a very vivid example of a software development community from various member states in collaboration with the European Commission. And this is also shows how open source is about co-creation. And not only about co-creation, it's also building public services that connect seamlessly across organization silos and borders. And honestly, what we are doing with LEOS, we want to do the same with all our internal software development practices. So we want to transform all our projects, all our IT projects, into internal communities. Now, next, another big step, going to the next slide, which is entitled Make Things Open. Another big step is, as the title says, is to make things open. Meaning, we want to make it easier to share our software with other member states, companies, and EU citizens. And not only that, we also want to allow our developers to contribute to relevant open source projects. However, the problem here is that in order to do so, in order to achieve this milestone, we need to remove some existing legal barriers. Well, you know very well, I mean, the Commission is bureaucratic, so cutting red tape is not easy. However, we have already started working on that, and we expect that we have the new rules in place sometime early next year. And this will enable a first step of existing projects to become open source. Actually, we have already started with sharing our PHP pre-configuration tools, and we hope very, very soon to give us open source the user interface that we use, the code and libraries, and our corporate search engine. So expect many things to come in the coming period in this context. Now, this These two actions that I have just presented to you will help change our internal culture. The next two actions that I'm going to present to you are focusing on evolving the open source community. So moving to the slide that is entitled Innovation Labs, what we are planning to do is we will be hosting open source labs in order to evaluate and experiment with open source innovative open source solutions. Actually, we have already reached out to our colleagues and we asked them already for suggestions that could bring a benefit either to the Commission or to European citizens. So, together with the open source community, together with the European SMEs, we want to test these solutions and we want to see if we're going to add them in our toolbox, either internally or for working with colleagues in member states. So that's why, as I said before, we hope that Appel and others will reach out to us because definitely we will be reaching out to them in the coming period. Well, that's a very important, as you understand, that's a very important action for us. Now, moving to the next slide, which is entitled Communities, this action is how we are going to increase our outreach to open source communities. So these open source communities, like the ones that we have worked with during the last 2 years, because, you know, the European Commission wants really to become a strong force in the community of European public services that are actively involved in the open source. You might know because that we have some experience in this area, because last year at the same conference, we have presented our EU FOSSA 2 activities. And actually, this new strategy builds on this kind of experience. So moving to the next slide, which is about EUFOSSA. Thanks to EUFOSSA 2, we have identified the most critical open source software. And not only that, we have also strengthened its security using bug bounties and hackathons. You know, we have to mention, it has to be mentioned that we have paid 200,000 euros in bug bounties. And we also organized three hackathons last year in Brussels that brought together many, many open source projects. And last but not least, we organized a very big conference that brought together Europe's FOSS leaders, which gave us a very, very good insight into the needs of European open source SMEs. So we really look forward to continuing that discussion. Now, other relevant activities in the open source, and moving to the next slide, concerns data center and ISA square and relevant things. And let me start with the data center, our data center, the Commission data center. Actually, we have started with open source already 2 decades ago. Nowadays, the LAMP stack is really the dominant force in our data center. And not only that, open source is used for the majority of the Commission websites and many online services. And you know that the default software development environment is based on open source tools. And upon request, any developer can receive an Ubuntu Linux laptop. And there are also many examples of open source tools that we share. For example, Eurostat shares many of its statistics utilities. JRC, the Joint Research Center, also makes available many of its scientific tools. The Commission also contributes by employing core contributors to Drupal, which is the corporate website content management system, as well to Hive Project, which is a software which makes it easier to respond to security, computer security incidents. So another example is the ISA Square. As you know, open source is about co-creation. So the focus for us at the Commission is also about building public services that connect seamlessly across organization silos and borders. We are trying to do this also internally. We want to break down these silos and borders. So the ISA program, as you may know, supports the development of digital solutions that enable public administration, businesses, and citizens in Europe to benefit from interoperable cross-border and cross-sector public services. Very, very important program. So, and what is also very important here is that all of the software that is built in that program, under that program, is made available as open source. So ISA has done an amazing work to advance open source. And the same is true for the Connecting Europe Facility, the EU funding instrument that promotes growth, jobs, and competitiveness at European level. So, and I would say that this quick overview will not be complete without mentioning the work done by our colleagues in Digi Connect, the Director General for Communication Network, Content and Technology. You know, among other, currently Digi Connect, they are doing a very important and very comprehensive study on the importance of open source software and hardware for Europe. This study was presented to you yesterday. I hope that some of you had the opportunity to attend this. Now, going to the next slide, I have to say that being an EU official, but also an EU citizen, I'm an advocate of openness. We believe that openness allows humanity to progress. The Commission has to lead by example, and we really hope to see all our software development teams adopt these working methods based on the principles of open source. Because open source allows for incremental innovation in a collaborative way, but also in an efficient way. And that includes you as well, all of you. So we're discussing about digital sovereignty. So honestly, to be digital sovereign, the EU will, among others, develop and deploy strategic digital capacities and infrastructure. So in the coming years, we will see the development of the next generation of digital technologies, including supercomputers, quantum computing, blockchain, and human-centered artificial intelligence. Open source will be the fundamental enabler and driver of innovation in those areas. So that is why we believe that this new open source strategy of the European Commission is of the highest importance. So thank you very much for your attention. We are at your disposal for any questions.
So we have a question in the chat, which I know you cannot see, Evangelos, so I will read it for you. It's from Alexander Sander. And it says, hello, I have two questions. We are pleased that the Commission recognizes the benefits of free software and the four freedoms to use, study, share, and improve. But the Commission lacks concrete targets and indicators to implement the strategy. Will you present and implement concrete measures and activities in the coming weeks and months? If so, which?
I think that I'm sorry, unless I misunderstood the question, these 10 actions that I presented to you the 10 actions that I presented are exactly what we are going to do. These are the really concrete actions, and I invite you again to have a look at these 10 actions. This is what we're going to implement in the coming period. And as I mentioned before, already and concretely responding to the question, the first action that has been implemented is the establishment of the Open Source Program Office of the European Commission. Important milestone. So this action is done. And already we are working on establishing the innovation labs. Concrete action ongoing. So I invite that you have a look again at the table that I put in the presentation. This table is also part of the communication, which is available online. I hope that I replied to the question.
Thank you. And there was a second part to Alexander's question, which was also the strategy says the principles of this strategy will help us choose strategically between closely competing software solutions. They keep our options open. They will allow the Commission to choose non-open technologies where there are good reason to do so, while encouraging us to plan for future open source alternatives. What are good reasons and where are they defined and laid down? Is there a public review?
Well, it's exactly, I believe that this is again part of what we discussed again, what we discussed during the presentation. We have a very concrete plan. with very concrete actions. Allow me to, for those that I know that is difficult, allow me to read again the 10 actions, very important actions. First action, set up open source program office. Second action, set and promote inner source as default. Third, enhance software repository. Four, revise software distribution practices. Five, enable and generate innovation with open source labs. Six, develop skills and recruit expertise. Seven, increase outreach to communities. Eight, integrate open source in internal IT governance. Nine, ensure security. Security is fundamental for us. It's the cornerstone. Whatever we do, the attention is always on security. Cornerstone of our strategy and of our actions. And last but not least, encourage and promote inner source. I believe that my presentation, our presentation, together with these 10 actions, I think that they give a very solid framework within which we are going to operate.
Well, thank you very much for answering both of those questions. And that is the extent of the questions that are in the Q&A chat online. If anyone else has any other questions, please let us know. And I don't see, Jill, I don't see any further questions coming in.
I actually got one via email. And that is, Evangelos, what advantages do you see in this broader strategy in the short term?
If I heard correctly, what advantages I see about this open source strategy in the short term?
Yep.
Okay. Well, first of all, and I would like that, to mention again, is that this strategy compared to the previous ones is not just an internal document. It is a communication to the Commission. It's a mandate to move and think and act open source. And this will affect the whole Commission. So the first important thing that already happened, and I will repeat again because it's very, very important for us, is the establishment of the open source program office. Second thing that is ongoing, and you will see it, actually, second thing that is you will see very, very soon, is that you will see a series of software, our software, become open source. Very, very soon. And this will happen. As I mentioned, we are working on the user interface modules and libraries, as well as on our corporate search engine. So it will come very, very soon. And of course, this will grow. You will see in the coming period, but this is for the short term. And if we say short term for me, at least in the way that we see it internally, short term for us is, let's say mid next year, okay, end of June next year. Let's say if this is considered also for you midterm. So this will happen. So you'll see more software to be open source. In addition, what is very important will happen very, very, very soon, early next year, is that, as I mentioned in my presentation, we are going to change the legal barrier that exists now, so that will allow us to make the and will not just allow, but also encourage our software to become open source. That's also short term. In addition, we want to establish the open source labs. As I said, we have already reached out our colleagues, and we are in the process of collecting their ideas. And the first quarter of 2021, we are going to establish the open source labs. So another important milestone within short term. And as I said, the labs is a huge step for us. So Just to recap quickly, what will happen in the short term is open source, more software will become open source. We'll change the legal barriers to allow the sharing of our software and also our developers to participate in open source projects. And last but not least, the open source labs.
Wonderful, thank you for that. And we just got another question that says, it sounds like you all are doing great, important work. Is there a way for developers and or community organizations to get involved?
If I understood correctly, I'm sorry for that. And it's a great question. So the question is how communities and companies can get involved with us. This is the question?
Exactly, yep.
Okay. Well, this is what we are going to do. And actually, we also want to find, and we hope to find ways to work closer with SMEs and individual developers. And the first step for that is the labs. Is the labs. But that's one step, one way to do that. So as mentioned in the presentation, we are going to reach them. We are going to reach through our network, through our contacts, we are going to reach the SMEs and individual developers. And as I said, first lab, the status of the labs will be one way, one step. But we also, another way of doing that is by opening our, by making our application open source. So by making the open source, we will foster collaboration and communication with the communities and with the developer. So, and not only that, you know, people, they say, oh, we don't know what you're doing in the commission. Well, by that, by opening our software, by making it open source, anybody will be able to have a look, an inside look into our kitchen. And not only have a look, people will be able, and communities will be able to get involved with us and we with them. So these are the two first steps, but be aware that we just started. We just started, and as I put in the slides, don't hesitate to contact us. We are there. Don't hesitate to contact us. Definitely, I can assure you, we will contact everybody.
Awesome. Thank you so much for answering that. And I think Jennifer got some more questions in as well. Jennifer, if you want to take those away.
Thank you, Jill. So we have a question. Do you have clear measures for developing open source outside of the European Commission ecosystem? And how will you promote open source based products developed by European SMEs?
I missed the first sentence.
Sorry, it said, do you have clear measures for developing open source outside of the European Commission ecosystem?
No, it's a very good question. The open source strategy is not about that. It's a very interesting question, nevertheless. But the open source strategy of the European Commission is internal. It's for the European Commission. It is not to put standards for, you know, in the context that you just, that the question just described. But as in continuation to the previous, question, with the idea of fostering the collaboration between the Commission, and the open source communities and individual developers, will generate a discussion towards a direction. I mean, if when SMEs, individual developers, for example, will come to our labs, to our open source labs, to test applications together with us, this will create a discussion in that direction as well. So we as European Commission can only participate together with the communities and companies in the discussion, but we cannot lead this discussion.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'm just checking to see if we have any other questions that have come in. Jill, have you received any other questions?
No, nothing else has come in to me.
Okay. Then I believe we are all set.
So we are all set with questions. So Evangelos, as we close out, is there any final words you'd like to leave with?
First of all, I again apologies for this technical problem. Sorry for that. I want, first of all, to thank all of you that attended this this event. What I want to pass a last message is, please get in touch. Get in touch with us. You have the contact details, and we really, really, really hope to work with all of you. So get in touch.
Wonderful, thank you. And yes, I've had your Let's Keep in Touch slide up. So again, we'll be sharing the slide deck and everyone can see that information if you would like to connect with them via Twitter or email or their website, that is all available there.
Thank you very much, thank you.
Thank you so much. And all of you. Thank you for joining. Thank you all for joining us. And I just want to do one final check that Jennifer, that we're all set and have no more questions.
Thank you. Bye.
No questions. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you all. Thank you, Evangelos. Everyone have a great day. Bye. And enjoy the rest of the event.
Bye.